somewhat from the outside. And as I think it's probably the case of virtually all of us. And the journey that got me there, that gets me there, remains an important part of my identity, an important part of what my religious life is always about. So I keep saying, as I write introductions to new books, I've been teaching Jewish theology for 50 years, but I still see myself primarily as a seeker. I said it in Radical Judaism, I just find myself saying it again in something I'm writing now. And that means that my my relationship to any answers that wind up being provided always remains tenuous, because I'm really committed to Bakshu Fanav Tamid, the sense that that quest is unending. And and that becomes a vital point of my whole relationship to the tradition. So I had to, in that context, provide a little piece, a little text here, because you quoted one of my favorite passages in the Zohar, and so I wanted to quote, and I told her she made enough copies, let me see if there are enough. I wanted to. This is the Ketem Paz. On that, did you get one? On that Zohar passage, Nadav Sharim Ba'ala. Ketem Paz is Rabbi Shimon Lavi. He was a rabbi in Tripoli in the 16th century, very obscure person. He wrote this commentary in the Zohar, which is really very, very nice in places. It's one of the commentaries in the Zohar that's more or less pshat and doesn't immediately try to tie it into Kabbalah Ta'ari. So you remember this wonderful passage, Nadav Sharim Ba'ala. And that means sha'arim, it means the gates, but it also means mashim sha'er b'libo, what a person imagines. The sha'ar becomes the sha'er, to imagine. And so God is what one imagines in one's heart. Actually, the Zohar is contrasting this with what it thinks should be, which is you should know the Torah tasbirot, you should do it right. But nevertheless, it evokes this beautiful image of sha'arim. And you quote that, is that drash shebesod or remez shebesod?
I think I brought in as the interlude towards sod, because I wanted to deal with the authenticity of imagination that has to be restrained by a spiritual quest.
So he says. No creature can know the wisdom of God. V'chol shekeir la'atzmuto, certainly not the nature of God. L'fishu amok amok miyim tse'enu. V'chakira bonim na'at me'an nivraim. We really can't even investigate it. Ha'elyonim v'atachtonim. Ad yukulu amre baruch v'od Hashem im komo. Until that's all any of them can say. Ki lo ra'ulo makom yuchad, shigbelehu. They've never seen a particular place that can contain God. Ki el yonim bevakashatam la'asig mekomo ha'ne'alam mehem, choshvim shulamata. Batachtonim choshvim shulamala. Right, the upper creatures are chasing him below, and the lower creatures are chasing God above. Shne'emar huma al shamayim Elohim, al kol ha'aretz kvodecha. Nimtza shekulam nevochim, v'kashato tamid. So all of them are confounded in seeking God always. Lo yechashu. They never stop. Ad shomrim, baruch vod Hashem imkomo, shu ne'elam mehasik. So wherever God, whatever God's place is, baruch vod Hashem from there. V'ulai, kisverat rabi yudha bazeh shebakashatam zot chivat nuat kotzla ha-shamayim. And he says, that's what makes the heavens go round. This constant seeking is what turns the heavens around. Skip down a little bit.
That's really his addition here, this bakash. That's very nice.
This is not no Pali about this. But Kisvarat Misha Marshim Hata Kavana, Sivuvla Sig, in the Pamori Shonava Shini, Lushlovi Sigul, the Sikhut Tekashev. They're going around and around. You would say, well, the person might say, well, if they didn't get it the first time, didn't get it the second time, maybe they should stop. He says, no, that going around and around, that's what makes the world go round. Ki koha mishtokek lo yanuach milevakesh. Gam ki lo yimtza. Uchukat ha-ra'aya el hadod. The longing of the beloved for the lover. Sh'ne'emar akumana v'asovva v'ir. V'ashvakim v'arachovot. Avaksha ha-chava nafshi. Bikashti v'lo mitzatim. Och, Mishir Hashirim. והבן שכתוב ידבר בלשון עתיד, עקומה, אסובבה, אבקשה, שירמוז שהיא אומרת שאף על פי שביקשתי ולא מצאתיו, עוד אבקשנו עוד, כי לא תנוח בקשתה ממנו לעולם, כי הוא חייה, הוא, meaning he, this, the goal, but also the בקשה, it is חייה, וכן שוקת העליונים ובקשתם תמיד, so this quest is one's sustenance. Chukata olam, chukata el yonim vakashatam, the chuka tamid, hu mezonam v'kiyumam. V'meinam mesigim, al kol zot, hem marvichim sheva hu gdula v'kavod v'vakashatam, et pnei adon. It even not getting, you don't never get there. But nevertheless, that's what gives you, the quest itself gives one sheva bakasha, sheva hu gdula v'chavot. Asher hem mevakshim, ki hu kiyumam v'kiyum kol nivra'ei mata. That's enough.
That's amazing.
I just wanted to, since you brought that down, share that. So that, I guess, is who I am. That sort of bakshufanav tamid. What I gave you to read from Radical Judaism is a rewrite. I am probably not going to publish a new edition of Radical Judaism in English. After I did the Hebrew, I thought I'd do a new edition in English based on the Hebrew. But somebody said to me, who's going to buy it? If people read the book already, they're not going to buy a revised edition. And so I'm doing bits and pieces elsewhere. That chapter on Tfilah you read is going to be published in a different volume. But here I rewrote the end. This is really for this class. I rewrote the end of chapter 2 and beginning of chapter 3 because I needed to say some things I hadn't said in the original. Yes, I do think that this moment of openness to dialogue between Eastern and Western religions is a very important moment that we're living in, and we should learn something about it and do it well. Josh, you're more involved in this than most here. And going to Seattle, maybe also a place where more of that can happen. The way we were open to Plato and Aristotle in the 10th century all of a sudden, and tradition changed because of it, I think this encounter with the traditions of the East might open us to thinking more about oneness in different ways, and God as the of course the absolute and the and ingraspable at the same time. I think that those are traditions that would help us with that language and would help us get away from the old fellow in the sky who never quite leaves us alone, whom we never quite outgrow in the Western traditions, and who causes so many people and so many parts of us, dare I say it, to say, oh, I don't believe in that, and then close the door. That childish personification is something I think we have never quite gotten away from, and Judaism doesn't help us very much in getting away from it, because it throws us back into it every time we open the Siddur, and so we have a hard time with that. And I think that East-West dialogue might help us in this, as I say, reclaiming a Jewish monism or panentheism. And then the question of how you read the tradition, how you read the Torah to get there. of course. I don't go with as complex a model as you do with the four gavels, but I certainly am looking for something like that. That is to say, a way to read the texts of the tradition, the Torah text, but also the Hasidic texts themselves, their rereadings, to go to this moment of seeing something deeper, of seeing beyond. One of the things I've discovered in reading Hasidic sources is that, especially the Baal Shem Tov seem to have modeled this, a new and different reading of a text that's familiar is kind of, I call it like the Zen master's slap. It sort of wakes you up to a different kind of consciousness. Wow, zap, I never thought of that. And that somehow takes you to a different level of consciousness or a different frame of mind. It's rabot machshavot belev ish, tzat Adonai hitakum. We have in that pasuk from Tehillim somewhere, I'm sure we have it in the Shacharit. Rabot machshavot belev ish, tzat Hashem hitakum. So, I read somebody this week who says, the fact that you have so many thoughts in your mind, that's God's doing. God has put them there so you can raise them all up. Therefore, takum, get up and do it. Atzat Hashem, rabot machshavot belev ish, atzat Hashem hi, takum.
Oh, wow.
God has sent you all those thoughts. You think they're distracting thoughts keeping you from prayer, but in fact they were all, that's atzat Hashem. God sent you all those thoughts so you can raise them up. So, do it. That kind of moment, and there are 1,000 moments like that of rereading texts. In a kind of, yes, calling to you, calling the tradition, calling to you. Mikra Kodesh, as far as Emmet likes to say, Mikra Kodesh is something, the holy calling, something that calls you. The Moadim are called Mikra Kodesh because they call to you to a different kind of spiritual place. They call to you to go into a deeper level of your spiritual self. That calling. Sometimes I feel it's more bakasha than tzivui. Sometimes I feel that voice calling out in a kind of desperation. I need you to hear me, because nobody's listening, because so few people are listening, because human civilization has run in a different direction. The secularization of consciousness and the pursuit of the endless pursuit of creature comfort and all the other things that fill our world, that occupy the minds and waking hours of most of humanity. I sort of feel that voice is calling out and say, somebody listen. And my religious life, our religious life, I think is a response to that call. As I say very clearly in Radical Judaism, in the earlier parts which you read, I think I understand all the forms of religion to be human creations, but they're all human creations in response to the call of the One, the call of God, that says, know me, be aware, listen, pay attention, and create forms to help you pay attention, because you're so easily distracted, you humans. And so we create those forms, hoping to help us to pay attention. And we are given the text too, to help awaken us to that attention, if we use them well. And most of those who are involved with the textual tradition even don't use them very well. Get over-involved in the halakhic detail of the text or in the critical approach to the text, and don't let the text become the calling devices that Mikra is supposed to be. Mikra doesn't just mean scripture, of course. Mikra, translated Mikra as scripture, is wrong. Scripture is writings, Miktav. But Mikra is calling. Of course, reading and calling is the same word. You read it and it calls you. You call it out. It calls out. You call it out. It calls out to you. We never quite know which of those is happening. They're both happening at once, of course. I think we both understand the difference between us and prior generations. You say it in Sod, and I say it in this beginning of chapter 3, that we do not have a map of the universe. We do not have a Kabbalistic cosmogony, which says this is the way the world is, and the spheroids are really so-and-so, and those are the secrets of the universe, and now come let me show you. We have fragments of that, we have broken fragments of that tradition that we turn to for inspiration and for pathways inward to deeper consciousness, but we do not believe that that's how the world came to be, or that that's the, Kabbalah is no longer a science for us. And I think we both admit that pretty clearly. At the same time, we are both attracted to those fragments, and those fragments we find have great insight and lead us to places of inward quest and insight. And that's what they are, but we don't try to claim that we really are what we really believe, what our ancestors believed, which is to say, this is the map of the universe. I think the challenge is the same for both of us, turning back to Torah, turning back to the text. And when I say Torah, I mean the text and the praxis at the same time, as a way of giving life and putting flesh on our life of personal quest. And if you ask why we do that, why does the seeker need the tradition? Okay, I hear that loud and clear from some of your questions. Why does the seeker need the tradition? My answer is that the tradition gives a kind of, I call it the echo chamber of antiquity. It gives that kind of deeper, gives it a kind of depth that the individual quest doesn't have. There is something about us as 21st century people who could just take a little bit from here and a little bit from there and gain wisdom from wherever we want. And that's the way my contemporaries saw it, take a Rumi poem and take a little bit of Zen and a little bit of this and a little bit of that and a little bit of Judaism and put it together, because what it's really about is your own individual quest, and you put the package together, so make the package however you like. And everybody's package will be different, of course, because I was turned on by so-and-so and you were turned on by so-and-so. And I wanted a kind of authenticity and depth that kind of arbitrary putting together didn't allow for. And so I found myself going back to tradition after I had walked away from it, because it allowed for that sort of resonance. And for that, for that resonance that we just made mm-hmm. there. I think I'll leave it at that. I had some various other bits and pieces, but I think I'll just leave it there. I really want to open the door for you folks to say, this is our last chance together. So what would you like to ask, raise, talk about? Go ahead.
So I was curious to hear you talk about, I think you started with it earlier, about like theology as an attempt to clarify where we stand, and that it has like some very practical consequences, right? That was sort of part of your introduction to the class. And that was really interesting to me because I don't think I've seen a lot of practical consequences in what we've been reading so far. Maybe I'm just too dense to see them, but in terms of like what are like the concrete, practical, like that word stuck out to me, because that wouldn't have been an adjective that I chose.
So tell me what's behind that, like.
I, I, studying for practical consequences, there would be an answer to that question of like, so what do you do? Or if that's too personal, at least, how do you want to help the readers figure out what they do? And I feel like I've heard more, I don't feel like that's been in, does anybody else
this very subtle and complex hermeneutical process, how does that relate to your ma'as, which is obviously very traditional, but it's not quite clear how the, am I right? How the theoretical hermeneutical
I was hearing it that you wanted me to provide more of a guide. It's obviously in a different way, but when I've done commentaries, right? Mm-hmm. The question I've always faced in writing commentary is, if I know more than my reader, how do I present the selection, present the order of understanding, because I am the more knowledgeable guide, but at the same time open up a space of freedom that a person could make choices between various alternatives. They can become a reader on their own. So there's an issue of authority and also giving freedom. In some way, that was my approach here. There's a lot of the personal in the selection, in the articulation, but I wanted to allow a person to struggle with those texts on their own or push back. This doesn't make sense to me, I'm going to go. You know, this is just one person's articulation based on a lifetime of thinking and reading. But it's not necessarily, I wanted to kind of bring threads of my life together at this point, but I didn't want my voice to give you a practical way of going about this. So if in some ways, I don't want to leave you too confused, but I don't want to provide a reader's guide to how you live a religious life. I want this to strike you as authentic, that this is written from this moment by a particular person who's been shaped by a lot of contemporary things and traditional things. And then you have to find how you make this, you know, theology lamaze. I mean, that is, or you say, I can't go this direction, I have to do something else. That's, for me, perfectly okay. You know, if you want me to answer that in particular ways, I'd be happy to do that. But as a public document, I made a choice to keep the I voice only coming through occasionally, but the presence of the I is always, it's there in every single line.
No, I hear that, and I think it could be I think it could take the form of a guide. I think it could take the form of a question. Like, it's clear to me in the writing that there are practical consequences to the theology. And I understand what you said about why you don't want to be heavy-handed about what you think those consequences should be.
One consequence is I want to live a full Jewish life.
Sure.
And live an honest Jewish life. And want the text to resonate at multiple levels, because I live at multiple levels. I don't want to live stuck in metaphors that were given to me. I want everything to be stated as a prayer. This is where I stand on all of these. If these are the way the texts are channeling my thinking, they're going to help me. But it's not just for the mind. You have to live a Jewish life from morning to night. Everybody in a different way, but trying to do that in the most honest, forthright way. So it's a confession, it's a prayer, it's a way of this is where I stand. But if it was only that, for me, if it was only that, then people would identify with that position with only one person. And I think that I am trying to say something much larger of possibilities. But the rubber hits the road with what do you do?
Right. Or
what
even,
do you do?
Or even, like, I could even live with, like, a step before that of how do you decide what you do? Like, I don't think you necessarily, I understand why you wouldn't want to answer the question of what do you do, because you wouldn't want to sort of impose that on somebody else. But I think that the way I understood a lot of what we read was to say, like, okay, these are the things that motivate me to do something.
So let me give you a phrase that may help you, that is actually was used by Rosenzweig at one point when he had become Sabbath observer. But he still wrote. And someone came to him in the Lair House and said, well, since you write, would you at least sign this for us, because et cetera, et cetera. And then he articulated at that point, he used the phrase, which is really a Hegelian phrase, but he used it in a very personal sense. He says, not yet. Not yet. Not yet and never are very different phrases. So what it says is that you have to start somewhere. You have to do something. And then you have to see whether that can become a magnetic point in which other things can grow. And whatever your knowledge or your particular style is, you say, well, so this is now authentic. Now I can do this. Or in other words, it's a way of saying, I think that a Jewish person, even a very liberal Jewish person, has to come to terms with what Jewish tradition understands as chiyuv. What am I obligated to do? Now, chiyuv may be very different for a liberal setting, but it means I have to do this to live an authentic Jewish life. I have to do this. I can no longer do X on Shabbat, or I need to at least make some bracha at some point in the meal, or I'm not, right? There's a chiyuv that's not just coming from a shulchan aruch that's out there, but it's also there because it's part of the tradition. And does this fit right? Do I understand it right? And when I've given myself an interpretation, can I live it? And once I live it, the chiyuv is part of my own authenticity. I have to do this. Now, and I may even have to do this when I'm not in the mood, because that's part of who I have become. But I think that the phrase not yet has to give you a sense that I have a Jewish future. I'm not done. I want to see how it's going to hold together. Now, not yet may mean that other things may have to be totally revised and changed. That's going to depend on what kind of halachic life you want to live. But the not yet means I'm on a journey, and I want to have these things come together, the hooks come together, and I'm binding them together as I learn the tradition, as I do it. And then but I can't yet do that. But the yet, ode, right? That ode is a very, I use the ode a number of times because I think it's a very important adverb. Not yet. Yes, I can still do it. I can't yet do it. Or I'll do it again. And much more could have been done with that ode. I had to restrict myself because it would have gone off in too many different directions. But just think about that in terms of, what do I need to do to live a Jewish life? Or if I say to someone, how you have to start somewhere, right? Or else you're not doing anything. So start with this, and then what needs to be done to fill that out as a next step? Or that if I don't do that, it becomes a betrayal of who I'm becoming in terms of whatever kind of integrity I'm trying to develop. So this is, it's a very modern way of talking,
But chiyuv is essential, maaseh is essential, asiyah, you have to do these things, right? And you have to find your own way. You know, Ari has a whole book on the four worlds, but you have to find your way of what flows down to you for Atzilut, and what do you recreate, and what do you form, and what do you do? You could find a way to kind of reinterpret that if you wanted, right? But we live in all that, and you have to start with something to rebuild, or, you know, for people in your congregation, they may not start with kashrut. They may start with sorrow, and like, how do you deal with sorrow? How do you deal with happiness? And then what's the next, what else are you going to do? What else are you going to do? Your life isn't just one moment of sorrow or one moment of joy, right? What else are you going to do to fill out your own Shulchan Aruch? Not that it's set, it's going to spread out, right? So.
I think one of the ways that I would start if that question was raised to me is you can't talk about social justice until you also try to think through what it means to be a person. And you would want to help people through study of Jewish sources. What is a person? Why is a person unique? You can't, as they have their own boundaries, they have their own, you know, all the ways that we would want to think through what is person. What does it mean to do social justice if you don't have, we've lost a sense, and that's one of, at least from our generation, maybe Lizelle said it best, you know, one of the things that were murdered in the camps was the notion of a person, of the human being. But we're all trying to recover personhood too, and without a sense of the dignity of the person. Heschel wrote, you know, who is man? Not what is man, but who is man? So that's an important thing to keep in mind. It's not what is man, ma'adam, but me, right? So, I'm just throwing things out that way, but I wouldn't, if a person came to me and said, social justice is fine, but what puts it within the Jewish machane? Like, why is that, right? And I would say, because we have developed a notion of what it means to be a person, what it means for people to live together with dignity. What is tzelem Elokim?